Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Devorah Shanowitz, and I am program director and director of education at Chabad of Westmount. And it's an honor for me to have this privilege tonight to interview a man who just made history for the Jewish people. Yes, round of applause for that. And for the world, as we will find out in our conversation. People ask, why go to the moon? Why another lunar landing? What is the importance of it? And other questions. And those are some of the questions that I've been fielding as people, I reached out to people who said, what do we ask such an eminent scientist and engineer? But before we do, I would like to take the opportunity to have Alexander Friedman introduce himself and tell us his background and his position at Beresheet and the Lunar Landing Initiative.
Thank you. First of all, I want to say it's my privilege that Rabbi Yossi and Devorah invite me to take part in this very interesting and very, I think, important event. And I have the opportunity to take part of this very special evening. I was born in Russia many years ago, in 1950, in Moscow, and until the age of 6.5 years, I was born in Moscow because my father was arrested, and after he was 6.5 years in army during all the Second World War, and he was an officer and have very, very hard history in the world. But after this, like joking in Russia, like all good people, he's going to be arrested, especially because it's related to Chabad. And this was, I think, the real reason to this arrest.
So could you just clarify, what do you mean by that? Could you clarify for those people who are not familiar with the history of the persecution of Chabad in Russia, specifically because they were continuing to teach Judaism and to practice the Jewish faith? So I guess what we're saying is that your father was part of that community and as therefore was targeted?
Yes, I have the privilege to be from born connected to Chabad because my parents from both sides, my father, my mother, coming from families of connected to Chabad. So I'm from zero connected to Chabad. And as Dvorah say, in Russia, I think the security forces understood very well what is the real importance of Chabad to continue the Jewish life in Russia, and this was one of the reasons that they take a lot of effort to destroy this community of Chabad. Okay.
So I think a lot of people tonight, when they met you for the first time, they said, this is the systems manager of the Space IL lunar mission. Yeah. You're the mission director, so in a very prestigious position. And I overheard tonight when people saw you for the first time, they were like, wow, that's not what I expected him to look like.
Sorry, but this is the
So, you know, a yarmulke in a beard, you look like a Hasidic Jew. You look like you could be a Chabad rabbi.
No, rabbi, I cannot compete with Yossi, et cetera.
So my question to you is this, and this is something that I myself Yossi and all of us, we were obviously very intrigued to find out that you have such an important position and that you have a history in terms of you were systems manager for satellite companies in Israel for the Amos, systems. Can you?
Oh, thank you. I have the opportunity to be in the space business in Israel from the real beginning, from 1881, when this start in Israel. It start very interesting. I work in Israeli craft industry, and one day in some plant that is doing missiles, systems, etc., and one day the management of the company take something like 10 people from different places in the plant and puts it together in some room, close it, combination key, and tells them very simple. Now we need to start to learn how to do spacecraft, satellites. The first what we think when we have this statement, you are crazy, what is the connection between Israel and satellites? But we are good workers, they tell us to start to learn, and we learn. And we start to design the first Israeli satellites, Ofek and Horizon. And years after, we start to doing the first Israeli communication satellite, Amos-1. I have the opportunity to be the founder and the first manager of system engineering department in the space division. And I have also the opportunity to be the system engineer of Amos-1, 2, 3, and also I was responsible for the layup operation, that meaning operation after launch until the spacecraft comes to its final position and check all system ready for service. Also, I'm doing this for Amos-1 and Amos-3, and this is the third time that I'm doing this dual role of system engineering manager and mission director.
Well, that is quite an achievement.
But what I want to say you, it's not your question or your statement is not surprising me, because our main donor, Mr. Morris Kahn, tell me more or less 1 year later, after I start to work in this company, tell me, you know, Alex, when I see first time you see you, I was very, very bored. It's what doing this religious guy here? What I can do with him? What is? What will be? I don't know. And later we was in a very good relation with Morris. So it's surprised not only you, or it surprised many people.
So to follow up on that, as a esteemed scientist and as a religious Jew who wears his observance quite proudly, what message do you have for young people, whether they are observant or not, in terms of the dichotomy or the conflict between science and religion that is very bandied about? But in your personhood, we see that there is no conflict at all.
Yes, I really speaking, nothing exactly can understood the contradiction between these two things, because from my understanding, and also I think it's Lubavitcher Rebbe say many times, that's no contradiction between science and religion, because, you know, as religious people, we know that all the world is the creation of the God. And like it was a lady of art, painters, when you spoke about very nice painter, you want to see the picture. You want not want to hear it is nice. You want to see how he's doing and to understand, to see. And this is exactly the same, because we know that the world is created by God. We want to understand better the world, to understand how is fine, how is beautiful the world that God has created. So I think when we're doing this, we only try to understand better this issue.
I think it took a lot of people by surprise to find out that Israel was the fourth country in the world to attempt a lunar landing. right behind the United States, Russia, and China, which are world superpowers. And given Israel's existential issues, where it's constantly under the threat of, defensive threat in terms of military terrorism, economic threats with, the emerging BDS movement and other things. From its very foundation, the Jewish state has been really in a defensive posture. How is it that you find such an excitement and a creativity and even the ability for a science project that's so sophisticated that takes you to the fourth in the world stage when you're operating on a budget, a country's budget, which is so largely attributed to defense mechanisms and for security? How does this happen? Where does this idea even come from that you were told that you were locked in a room and said, "Hey, we're going to space. We're going to have a satellite." How does this happen when you are, really in survival mode? I think all of us have existed at one time or another where whatever situation we were going on in our personal lives, where we were kind of under survival mode, and at that time, all you think of is yourself. You don't think of science, and you don't think of technology, and you don't think of progress. How does Israel do that?
First of all, it's very interesting, but I can tell you that it's the government money was really nothing. It's very, very small part of our budget. And mostly all the budget is from donations. We spoke about donations. This is the donations that is base of this project. We are a company, non-profit company, and the company established, first of all established, I think, something like a joke, because three young guys sitting in bar, which bottles of beer, and they heard that is some competition of Google X Prize. They say, why not me? Why we can also doing this? And they prepare all documents and sent. It was very small payment, and they said that we want also to participate. After they said, we need to doing something, and they come to Mr. Khan, a very well-known philanthropist in Israel, and tell him we want to doing this, and give us, please help us. We need maybe a total budget of $10 million. It was very good estimation, but we need to add additional zero. and they tell, no problem, 2-3 years, we bring lander to the moon. And Mr. Khan agree, but it was a very, very important point. Our company was two major targets. Not only to design and build this lander to the moon, but the second target, and also I think it's connected to this evening, is education. The one of the official declaration of our company that we're doing a lot of effort to improve the education of real mathematics, physics, chemistry in Israel. And we have, I think, in education part of the company, more people than in technical part. And they do a lot of work in Israel. It come, it's hundreds, maybe thousands of lectures, different schools with children. Mm-hmm. And it was unbelievable interest in Israel due to this effort. And also our company declared that in case we won the X Prize, that we totally up to $36 million, something like this, if we achieve this and this and this. And in case we won this money, all the money will go to education, not to us.
So I just want to take the opportunity, we're talking about philanthropy, that one of the donors to the project, someone who you met, is a man from Montreal, very famous philanthropist in Montreal, Sylvan Adams. And he was involved in the project as well, and you had the opportunity to
meet him in Israel.
I think it's very interesting, segueing to what we just had, the panel on philanthropy, where we see that there's only a limit to what governments can do. Let's say in the state of Israel, where they're constrained by existential issues, or in other cases, bureaucracies, that philanthropy can come and step up to the plate in a very innovative way. I find it interesting that one of the differences, I guess, in this lunar mission was the way that you went up to the moon, which is I've seen it quoted as saying that you've taken an Uber to the moon, hitched a ride, and really it really economized the mission, so that there was a tremendous amount of economizing and being thinking outside of the box in terms of not just spending the money. Can you elaborate on how that was different? How was this lunar mission different than the other ones, the ones that Russia, the United States, and China conducted?
I think it's very different because in case of the superpowers, I think it was the national program. As I know, national program, especially in space, I will take practically unlimited budget because it's nation priority. In our case, we don't have national money, national priority. We have donations from different people around the world. Part of the people give the donation because they want to help to Israel to going to the very far frontier of science and to see the small country, big dream of the small country will be realized. Other donation was mostly because the education part. And we have very limited budget. And also we have something like 1 year before the launch, we stopped the work because the money is finished. Mm. And we cannot continue without the money. And our main leader, Maurice Kahn, that is not only the main donor, but is also the heart of this project, try to find additional donation going to state in different places and bring after 1 month money, and we continue to work. But we are in a situation that we stop the work. And this, of course, will have very big impact on our work. Because, for example, what you say, we are poor company, we cannot have special dedicated launch because to the moon, because it's possible, and most of the spacecraft are going to the moon doing this, but this kind of launch, I think, costs something between $60 to $100 million, at least. And our total budget, including everything, including education also, was less than $100 million. So we cannot using so nice solution. So we find different solution, not standard solution. It's like Uber. We find using some company, brokerage company, Spaceflight, that work with SpaceX of Elon Musk. And they propose us to be part of launch that take number of spacecraft. For example, the final launch that we have is based on the communication spacecraft, big communication spacecraft, close to 5 ton. And we are the secondary, we sitting on this big spacecraft on the top, and we pay, of course, because we are small, they're big, we pay also the small part of the launch cost. So, it gives us the opportunity to go, but due to this fact that it's not dedicated launch to moon, it's a launch for mostly designed for communication satellite. We have the orbit that is relevant for the communication satellite, and we need to go by ourselves to different orbit to come closer to the moon, and after this to capture the moon and going around the moon, going lower and landing. And this,
so there's a lot of creativity and innovation in the process.
Yes.
You say very different than the process.
We have a lot of innovation because nobody in Israel doing this kind of job to going to the moon. It's the first time for all our team. And especially part of our team was very young guys that never work in space. And so it's we need to do a lot of innovation. And we have, for example, a lot of maneuvers to correct the orbit. And all this design was very dedicated to this mission, to find cheap and creative solutions.
I read that there were volunteers that were very involved with this project, including students from high schools that as young as 15 years old that were doing research on behalf of the project. I find that to be quite mind-blowing, and that there were a lot of volunteers that played a part in the initial phases of this project. What drives a young person in Israel to get so involved in a project that he would give his time or her time from her or his or her high school activities, recreational activities, and to do research about the surface of the moon, where it's good to land? I find that to be quite fascinating. What do you think Israel can teach the rest of the world in terms of getting young people so excited and so interested in knowledge and science? What drives that in a society?
It was unbelievable. Nobody expects so impact, so very big impact on all Israel, especially children, because I know not only 50 years guys doing. I know that we have our grandsons of 3 years, 2 years, also all the time ask me, well, what is about your lander? Where you going? Where are you going? It was crazy impact. It's unbelievable.
Well, definitely see the emotion in the video when the people are waving the flag and they're saying the Shehachianu. The emotion that the average person is feeling.
It's unbelievable.
What would you say this least attempt at the lunar landing did for people in Israel?
I think, first of all, this the result of very hard work that doing our volunteers in education, because they really visit a lot of school, have a lot of lectures. We have special programs on this. And I don't know how to explain. We spoke many times about the Apollo effect that we try to do in Israel, like Apollo effect. I think, I don't know, very familiar with Apollo effect. I know what is this, but I think this was more. It's unbelievable what has happened. I going in the street, people stop me. No, what has happened? When you going this way? When you going this way?
So
from
what I've read, even NASA was impressed with what you did. Could you elaborate on that?
Yes. I personally was shocked when I heard the administrator of NASA, the chief manager of NASA, spoke about our project. NASA was very connected to our project. And that the statement that shocked me is that he say, it's our pleasure to be the partner of SpaceIL. Big NASA spoke of our very small company.
I want to ask you on a personal level, as a person who was born in the former Soviet Union and whose family suffered persecution, who was denied certain academic opportunities because of that, who was a refusenik, applied many times to leave Russia and was refused, who came to Israel as an immigrant in the 1970s, or 1970 rather, and yet to come back and to be in that space where you are doing something that very few countries have managed to do and you're heading it. How does that make you feel, first of all, as a human being in the terms of the triumph over the human spirit, but as a Jew, what does it mean for the Jews who 70 years ago were decimated by the Shoah, 70 years ago were decimated by Stalin's persecution, to be today a name on the lips of everyone who's interested in the future of science, and to say that you, who came from that persecuted background, is now leading your country and the Jewish people, really, for all of us, that sense of pride. What does that speak to you, and how did you feel when you launch that when you launch that spacecraft?
Yeah. First of all, I feel a lot of satisfaction. I never, when some guy tell me in Russia that I will come to Israel and build spacecraft, I think something not correct with him. But I think that I can to define this very short and very exact. One of the biggest our donors, Mr. Sheldon Adelson, asked from the project, he gave a lot of money, and asked the project only one thing, to put on the spacecraft the statement, Am Israel Chai.
Wow, now, and that is a wonderful way to end this off. I want to thank you for coming all the way from Israel to inspire us, and I want to end up with those words that Chabad of Wesmont wanted on the lunar lander. Am Yisrael Chai, and let's go from strength to strength. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. It was a real